stand.
Speak from here if you want, so I'll try.
You can speak from there, that's quite acceptable.
Yeah, these might be more just, I guess, a few disparate observations rather than really profound, but just thinking about the emails you sent Ken and some of the reading material was attached to it. I guess my first observation is the comment that we have a declining track record in discovery. And I think some of the early speakers commented on the difference between resources and mineable deposits, and I agree. Thinking in geological terms, I'd say collectively industry is pretty good at finding mineralized systems. The last 17 years I've been in uranium, 20 years prior to that was gold and base metals, so it's drawn from a variety of industries. But most field seasons we get on to, say, altered fault zones or that type of thing. So in terms of finding the conduits, the fluid rock interaction zones, I think we have a high success rate. What we have a much lower success rate at is finding the traps in those mechanisms, the loci of mineralization. Particularly those mineralized centers that develop into world-class deposits or economically mineable deposits. So I would just, I guess, characterize, if you want to call it exploration failure, it's that what some of the earlier speakers were alluding to is actually being able to find those world-class mineralized traps and is the key bottleneck there. A few thoughts on technology. Some of the readings referred to technology. We've heard a bit about it today. There was the one in particular that was talking about, I think, some of the readings from the oil industry, visualizing 3D volumes as opposed to 2D surfaces and things like that. And, you know, arguably that's all good stuff, having programs like LeapFrog or GoCAD where you can do 3D models. But I know one of the issues that Dave and I struggle with our crews, and we feel we have good jobs. We put them up against any other major company exploration group, but a lot of them haven't had the opportunity to work in field geology or think about field geology. So you have somebody doing a LeapFrog model that doesn't have the understanding of the geological template. So something as simple in our world in the Athabasca Basin, the phytic conductors, you see an offset in a conductor. The first thing that comes to mind, people will put a cross fault in there. But if you look at the mapping that the government geologists have done in the metamorphic basement below the Athabasca, it's an orogenic belt. We're dealing with folded rocks. So a lot of those offsets are just Z folds or S folds, but that's not the template that our geologists think of first. They immediately default to the simplest solution, which is these planar cross-cutting faults, 2D planar templates. Related to that is, I guess, having the experience to be able to discriminate, what John called the technical success. So our current target model is fault controlled. So the drill hole on a conductor, they hit a fault zone, and it might be a fault like that that's got an alteration zone to make it out wide, and get excited because we've hit a fault. Explain the geophysical part should we step out on this fault, but it's to think what does a world-class mineralizing system just look like in terms of something that's potentially economic in our world? What does a MacArthur River uranium deposit look like? And is this a fault that I should really be following up the next fault? So I guess what I'm trying to say there is we've got 3D EM inversions, we've got LeapFrog, we've got GoCAD, geophysicists talking to geologists, but we don't have people always thinking about the geological model or template that they should be pursuing. Research. This might come across pretty negative. I've been one of a number of champions within Cameco for a couple of major multi-party research efforts, XTEC, GFC driven there a few years ago, and most recently CIMIC Footprints. Both of them probably pretty successful in training HQP. So, lots of lots of students getting the chance to do a master's degree and getting trained up, coming out with a nice little study. X-Tech, incredibly successful, moving a lot of knowledge into the public domain. There was a very good volume that came out of X-Tech, so, you know, the GSC served their, they did what they're supposed to do, right? They moved a considerable volume of scientific knowledge into the public domain. But when I think of X-Tech, or I think of the current CIMIC footprint study, from a called a chemical point of view, we are not learning how to explore better from those projects. And one real failing of them, and I don't know how to overcome it, our subject matter experts have continually, in the footprints project, continually engaged the researchers, tried to get them to talk, pass on information, pass on advice. We just saw in the last talk about Peter's mentioned that nobody reads anything older than 10 years old. We find a lot of these bright young students, they're doing great work, but they're just getting, you know, by the time they leave, they're getting up to a level where one of our junior geophysicists or junior geologists has been working at for a number of years. So they're, the professors aren't, I guess, our observation would be directing them to the critical reading, you know, that old rule about if I've seen further, I've stood on the shoulders of giants, right? What was all that scientific knowledge from generations before is not being built on. It's like the current generation of researchers is just relearning what was already known. And I don't blame the students for that. The individual master's student is doing a really nice little thesis, nice piece of work, but they're not getting the direction they need. And my last and final point is one of the readings, the one about the, I think it was big expiration, small expiration, that pointed out the challenge with the word they use was contextual challenges of the world we live in, CSR issues and things like that. And making the point that explorationists have to be more than, you know, say what they were in the 1950s when you could just be a field-based prospector. Now it's all about risk and CSR and everything else. And that's fine. That's all true. And I think I'd argue that, you know, geologists has to have at least some broad awareness of the world around them. But what we see in chemical, and I'm sure other companies the same, we increasingly see what we call corporatization, where the poor geologist or geophysicist fills their day with so many other things, you know, in terms of CSR permits, check, you know, writing daily reports, weekly reports, monthly reports, constantly doing stuff that isn't what they were trained to do, which is look for ore deposits. And so in that sense, I'm not saying that things like safety, environment, CSR are not important, but I think what we need is people on staff that do that stuff and let the geologists, the geochemists, and geophysicists do what they've been trained to do, which is not for our bodies. That's all I have to say at this point.
Okay, thanks.